What you see here are the measurement results of 44 earthquakes distributed across the globe as recorded by seismometers in the formerly volcanically active Massif Central in France. Shown here is the deviation of seismic P-wave arrival times from the expected values, that are the travel time differences. Reddish colors show delayed arrivals, while bluish ones show arrivals earlier as expected. We see that the propagation velocity of the waves appears to slow down under the extinct volcanoes. You can see this here. This might be an indication of volcanic residual heat under the ground. But where exactly underground is this anomaly located? Hello and welcome. In this video, I will show you the significance of inversion procedures in geophysics. You will learn the most important terms relating to this concept and how we can use measurement data from the Earth's surface to draw conclusions about what is under the ground. Using a simple example, I will show you the formal relationship between observation and interpretation. We are familiar with direct measurement procedures from daily life, determining weight using scales, measuring length using a ruler, or determining the air temperature using a thermometer. These direct measurements deliver the desired result immediately. However, in geophysics, we measure various physical quantities outside in the open, or as we say, in the field. These field measurements taken with seismometers, gravimeters, geoelectrical equipment and other devices are all indirect measurement procedures. This means that the measured values only provide us with indirect information about what we are actually measuring, what is under the Earth's surface. The subsurface property we are looking for will then need to be inferred from these indirect measurements. One such indirect measurement is the travel time difference in our example from the Massif Central. This image shows a model of P-wave velocities under the Massif Central, along the profile line shown here. Reddish colors indicate regions with lower velocity, and bluish colors regions with increased velocity. You can clearly see a region with lower velocity in the area in the middle. The reason for this are variations in the density and the elastic properties of the rock. Among other things, this is dependent on the temperature. Hence, this zone is interpreted as being rock with residual volcanic heat, what we call a mantle plume, which supplied magma to the volcanoes up until 6,000 years ago. In this example, the connection between the propagation velocity and travel time is the travel path to the seismic waves. The longer they travel through slow zones, the later the seismic waves arrive at the seismometer. Hence, this simple transformation allows us to calculate expected travel times from underground properties we know. We call this a forward calculation. Other examples of such forward calculations are underground density variations, which lead to changes in gravity, or variations in the electrical resistance underground, which lead to changes in an artificially created voltage field. You have probably noticed that I claim to know what is going on underground. Naturally, this is not the case before a geophysical experiment. We scientists are actually interested in the reverse case, backward calculations. We also call backward calculations inversions. At the end, we have a model of the subsurface. However, this way back is not possible directly. It requires inversion procedures, where the key lies in the reversal of the transformation rules. We need to create this key mathematically. The measurement data needs to be consolidated in the data vector D and the underground properties in the model vector M. Often, the underground model is divided into blocks for this purpose. Each entry in the model vector then corresponds exactly to one block. Both vectors are linked to each other via the transformation matrix G. The latter has exactly as many rows as the length of D and as many columns as the length of M. This allows the forward calculation of D from M, but not the other way around. Now the mathematical key comes into play. In order to obtain it, we need to invert G, but this is only possible when the data and model vector are equally long. That means G is a square and the data is free of measurement errors. In practice, however, both are generally not the case. Let me show you this using the simple example of fitting a line to specified data points. Let the line be our model M. It consists of two parameters, the gradient and the intercept. In this case, the forward calculation would be specifying points that lie on the given line, which is a really easy thing to do. For the backward calculation, there are various cases. If only one point is known, there are various lines which pass through it. In this case, the problem is underdetermined. The solution is not unique and no key is required. For two points, the answer is clear. If both the data D as well as the model M consists of two parameters, there can be no errors. The solution is unique, and the key for calculating the solution is the invertible transformation matrix G. Including additional data causes the problem to be overdetermined. The amount of data is greater than that of the necessary model parameters. The data points can now be optimally matched via a line of best fit. To calculate it, the key could be, for example, the method of least squares. As soon as erroneous data points are involved, the solution is no longer unique, and the calculation of the key becomes more difficult. In this case, it is then important to define a fitting error f that should be as small as possible. F then equals the difference between the measured data D and the forward calculated data G times M. It can be shown that the fitting error F reaches its minimum when the model vector M is equal to the inverse from the product of the transposed matrix GT and G times GT times data vector D. In this case, the product GT times G is now quadratic and hence invertible. The key for inversion is therefore this part here, which is called the generalized inverse. This formula represents one of the most important inversion concepts in geophysics and makes it possible to create images of underground structures such as mantle plumes, but also images of the human body using computer tomography. In this video, I showed you how inversion can be used to calculate a model of the underground properties from indirect measurement data. Hence, it is crucial to minimize the fitting error between the measured data and the forward calculated data. The mathematical key for this is the generalized inverse. Despite this, inversion results are often ambiguous and, due to data errors, only show one possible image of the subsurface. The greater the quantity and accuracy of available measurement data, the more reliable the model image of the subsurface will be.